Welcome to the program on African American history. This is a celebration about African Americans who have come to live in Fairfax County. We are celebrating with two families, the Lee family and the Collins family. James Edward Lee was born a free African American. He brought his family here to Fairfax County. The other patriot is William Collins, and he was born a slave. That's William Collins Sr. He came with his family and he brought them all to Maryfield. These families struggled for freedom and made a wonderful community that is thriving today. Marion Dobbins is here with her two aunts to tell about how these two families merged in the early 1900s to become one. So let us start a conversation with four women on African American history in Fairfax County. Marion, how about starting right off and telling the audience, people who are viewing this, what's the difference between a free African American and a person that's born a slave?
Well, Naomi, the difference is my great-great-grandfather, James Edward Lee, was born free. He was born free because his mother was free, so it was based on what your mother was. If your mother was a slave and you were born, then you were a slave. If your mother was free, then you would be free. But freedom really wasn't what we think of freedom. If you were born and you were considered a free African American, you had to register by law in the county that you were living in, and you had to go to the courthouse and register that you were a free Negro. And you registered on the Free Negro Registry. So we find James Lee, my great-great-grandfather, and his mother, Lucy Lee, are both registered on the Free Negro Registry in Fauquier County. And that's how I know that James Lee was free. Now, if you didn't register and you didn't have your papers, if someone came to you and said, I need to see your free registry papers, and you didn't have them, then they could then subsequently put you into slavery.
Now, so, didn't Virginia make a law?
They did.
What was the law?
The law was that you had to register, and that once you registered, you had 1 year to leave the state of Virginia if you were free. But that law really wasn't enforced, because even though the system of labor was based on slave labor in Virginia, the planters still needed people who were free that were African American to work in their plantations. So even though the law said, and the law was created around 1806, and it said that if you were free, you had to register and you had 1 year to leave the state, most African Americans who were free did not leave the state. They would stay here just like my great-great-grandfather did, and they made a life for themselves in Virginia.
Now, one of your grandparents was a mulatto, right?
Well, James Lee is registered as a mulatto, as his mother is registered as a mulatto.
And that is?
That means that, well, we know that James Lee's mother, Lucy, was African American. So James Lee being registered as a mulatto, his mother is African American and his father is white.
Okay, well, let's go and skip right to how he got the land and came here to Fairfax County.
Well, that's an interesting story. I love talking about that. As I said, Lucy Lee was born free. She registered. Her first registration, I find, is in 1836, where she actually registered in Fairfax County. Then she moved to Fauquier County, where she registered her two-month-old son, who was James Edward Lee, my great-great-grandfather. And she registered him in 1840, and that's why I know his birthday. And on the registration, he is listed as being a mulatto. James Lee and his mother and his other siblings lived in Fauquier County for many, many years. And when the war broke out, you find a letter that's written from General Johnston of the Confederacy to a marshal in Fauquier County. And the letter says that we need all free Negroes that have their own shoes of good, sound mind and body and have a blanket. We need you to gather them up, and we need you to bring them to the Centerville, Manassas area to dig entrenchments for the Second Battle of Manassas.
So you have a relative that was in the Confederate service, sort of working for the Confederates in a way.
Well, he wasn't in the Confederate Army,
no.
And the way the letter is written, it seems more like he was strong-armed into doing it. So I don't think he really had a choice, mm-hmm. even though he was free.
Yeah.
You know, he couldn't own land, he couldn't vote, he couldn't do the things that normal freemen would do. So after the Civil War, James Lee comes down to Falls Church, where he and his brother purchase land and they become farmers. Mary was James Lee's wife. They have children, and they have a son, Arthur, who Arthur has a son named Avon, and Avon is my grandfather. Now, Avon Lee marries my grandmother, who's a Collins, who is living in the Mason District,
right.
And that's how the two families get together.
Okay, let's jump over to you, Dolly, and you will tell us about the Collins family.
Well, starting from William Collins Sr., they came from Suffolk County on up to Great Falls area, and they were sharecroppers. And he lived over in the West Broad Street area, Falls Church. So he married Mariah Fish, and they had children. This is where William Jr. came in. And William Jr., after a long period of time, grew up and he joined the Spanish-American War, and he became a Buffalo soldier. And he, when he stitched in the army, he saved his money, sent his money back home to William Sr. so that William Sr. could purchase the land for him to, as we call it, the Pines. He bought the area and he divided the land out between his father and his siblings. And he's also saved enough land in the Pines that was given to his children as they grew up.
By serving in the Spanish-American Army, did he get special treatment, a little bit better treatment as a African-American?
As a civilian, he did. And we were going to school, and this is my generation that I'm talking about now. We would walk to school, and the whites would try to run over us with the car, or if they had a horse or whatever, would try to run over us, and the children would, we would walk. The white children would ride the bus. They would throw things out of the bus to us to try to harm us, and some of them, when they got off the bus, they would be close to where we live, and they would try to fight you. Well, we would tell my grandfather, and a lot of the whites around there respected him as a soldier, you know, and respected the people who had been in the service. So he would go to them and tell them, this is my grandchild, this is my, whatever it is, grandchild or child, we don't want you to be meddling with our children. And they respected him, and because he was respected because he was in the service. Also because he wasn't really, really poor. He had quite a bit of things that he had saved. He believed in saving a quarter if you had a dollar. And he instilled that in all of us as we were growing up. You save a quarter out of every dollar that you make. And he was able to get what he wanted to get by doing so.
Well, Myra, what was life like?
Well, to me, I was practically raised in Falls Church. And when we left Falls Church to come up in the Pines, I thought I was almost in the jungle because it was so woody. And where we were in Falls Church, well, we had a big house and we had also sidewalk, and I lived near the church, and we could go, I could go out and roller skate with my girlfriend across the street. When I got in the Pines, I couldn't do that. I had to go up on the highway to roller skate a little bit. But all in all, it wasn't too bad after you got used to it. But it was kind of hard for me the first time. And then finally, I got used to it. And I didn't like the idea I had to walk so far to school when all I had to do, I would be 5 minutes from the school where I was in Falls Church.
How far did you have to walk?
We had to walk like 2 miles to school. And just like my sister was saying, you know, the kids on the bus, they would be so nasty and all. So my cousin and I, we decided, well, the next time they get off the bus, we're going to run them right home, right up until their door. And that's what we did. Because we said we weren't going to let them keep messing with us. And then, telling us, calling us names and things like that. So we ran them right up to the door, and that's when we got them. And we started fighting right there in the front yard.
Okay, let's talk about the name of the Pines. And I don't blame you for doing that.
The name of the Pines was, my grandfather cut a road through there, and there was a lot of pine trees in there. So after he cut that road through there, he left a lot of those pine trees in there. So then they started calling it the Pines. So that's how we always said it was a pine. But it, all in all, we had a lot of fun because we had games and things that we played, and we just enjoyed life.
Well, tell us the sad story of what happened to the Pines.
Well, unfortunately, in around 1965, when Fairfax County was desegregating their schools, they were looking for land to build a new high school. And my understanding is there were a couple of land areas that they were looking at, and they felt that my grandmother's property was the prime site for
it. Do you say public domain? Would you say that was public?
Oh, it was eminent domain.
Eminent domain.
They came and they told them that they wanted to have the land to build a high school, and that they had 90 days to get out. And if they did not get out, the county would come and condemn the land and take it. What's really sad is that my grandmother's father, William Collins Jr., had always instilled in her the importance of land. And when he died, he gave her that land along with her brothers. And when they had to then turn that land over to the county, it almost broke. It broke my grandmother's heart because they owned this land free. Their houses were all paid for. They didn't owe anyone anything. But when the county came and took the land from them, they gave them money, which wasn't enough for them to build a house. And even though Fairfax County in 1965 was becoming desegregated, you couldn't just go into any community and purchase a home. So they had to still go into the black community, mm-hmm. And they had to get a mortgage. Well into their 60s, they had to then get a mortgage, my grandmother and my grandfather, and they built another house and started a new life, basically, in debt, when they weren't in debt. But we still continued the same traditions, that Grandma Betty started with the food after church, yeah. And anyone coming by, Grandma Myra Lee continued that, and then it still goes today. Last Sunday, I had everyone over my house, and we did the same thing. We ate after church, we sang hymns, and did the same things that the family's always done.
Well, don't you feel it's the church why you're such strong people? Most of your life is in the church and around the church.
That's right.
My grandfather, William Sr., he's one of the founders of the First Baptist Church of Merrifield. It was on Gallus Road, just before you get to Lee Highway.
Did you say it was a log cabin? You said it was a log cabin?
It started out in a log cabin with all the local area who was getting ready to start a church. They met in this log cabin down at Graham Road, and from there they branched off to, like, Mr. Bradley gave the land to the people in the area of First Baptist Merrifield to build a church, and the same with Second Baptist and Warner Baptist. They did the same thing, and they all branched out and got their own churches. But before that, they were all meeting in the log cabin at the Graham Road.
And how big is the church now?
Merrifield, it seats about 500.
Oh, that's a lot. Well, let's talk about how medicine was at that time. So who wants to talk first about, if you got sick, what did you do?
Well, if you got sick, you didn't get a doctor in the home. You always had to be taken to the doctor. And I remember my mother used to have to take us over there near Railroad Avenue over in Falls Church to the doctor there. But they wouldn't come to the house. And he was a white doctor. And then we had, if we were really sick, we had to go all the way into Washington, D.C. to go to Freedman's Hospital. We passed hospitals right there in Virginia, and they wouldn't accept you. So we had to go into Washington, D.C., don't care how sick you were. And you could almost die before you got to the hospital.
Let's talk about the schools, because I know you went only to a certain grade, but you could go further into Manassas. Tell me about school.
Well, I started in Falls Church. I was started down there, and I left there when we went to Merrifield. I was in the third grade, and I went to Merrifield Elementary School, the seventh grade. And then that was as far as I went.
Now that was an all, in that time you said colored school, wasn't it? They called it colored. They called it colored school.
One room school with a potbelly stove in there. And we had to walk. Sometimes we would be so cold when we got there, teacher would have a basin of water there for us to put our hands in. So we, you know, wouldn't freeze up. That was the only way we could get the circulations back in our hands.
Did you have books, good books, or?
We had second-handed books from the white schools. Half of the pages weren't there, and it just wasn't really good. I don't remember even having a new book.
Now, you went further. So what school did you go to?
I left a two-room school in Murfreesboro. We never had water or anything in the two-room school. It was still outhouses and a pump. But after I left Murfreesboro, I went to Manassas. We had to walk from the Pines, as we call it, to Murfreesboro and at Lee Highway and catch the bus to go to Manassas Industrial High School. And we got up there, and it was almost the same condition. You didn't have the facilities like you had down here. You would keep your coat on all day long. We didn't have the books like we normally had, and the teachers would use the, I guess they call it Ditto machines, and that's what they would run off our lessons from one book that they may have, and we would go to the blackboard and do the rest, you know, out of whatever she would give.
There was something good about that, though. Weren't your name Miss Manassas? What did you tell me?
In 1947, I became Miss Manassas. Like the homecoming,
queen. Well, that was joyous. What type of entertainment did you have during those years at the Pines?
Music was a basic entertainment, and we would even in the summertime we would start out in the yard, and my cousin, mostly everybody had an instrument. I mean, they could play any kind of instrument.
Do you play an instrument?
I do. I play piano.
And do you play an instrument?
Play my way. I did it my way.
We would all sit down with the guitar. And I had a blind uncle, my mother's brother, who could play anything. And he said that his eyesight was in his hands. And he would build, he would do a lot of things. But anyway, we were being entertained by them playing the guitars, and we would be sitting around singing.
Well, did you have any movies you could go to? Or?
No. Well, later on in Merrifield, when Miss Coleman came, that was that teacher, they had a movie at the Oddfellows Hall.
Oh, I heard about the Oddfellows, yeah.
We could go up there on Friday nights, but that was the only movie. And that was when we were in our teens then, when we didn't go nowhere, you know, in the movies when we were in elementary school.
Well, even in the 60s, there was a drive-in theater, Merrifield Drive-In. I could not go there. Even in the 60s, it was segregated.
Let's go back to James Lee for a second because of the school. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to talk about the wonderful things that he did with his land, one of the sons.
Well, James Lee, when he came to Falls Church, he acquired land, and he has anywhere from like 12 to 15 acres. And he and his wife have children there, and he becomes what they call a gentleman farmer. He's raising produce and selling it and doing things for the community. And it's interesting, he writes a letter that when he comes to Falls Church, which is right after the Civil War, it's like 1866, he meets a gentleman by the name of J.D. Reed, who is a white minister. And Reverend Reed and his daughter, Betsy, are teaching the African Americans how to read. So he's being taught how to read. But the thing is, Reverend Reed gets killed because the white people there are upset that he's teaching the African Americans how to read. But then his daughter, Betsy, continues to teach the African Americans to read. Don't know if James Lee already knew how to read before then, or if Reverend Reed and his daughter taught him. But I really think he did know how to read. He acquired a lot of things. He paid taxes on a sewing machine. He had a carriage. He had horses and cattle. So he lived a very productive life. When he died, he willed some of his property to his son. And his son gave some property to the county to start the first Negro school there, which then became James Lee Elementary School. and now it's James Lee Community Center.
And the archaeology department of Fairfax County is in there. So I've been in there a lot of times. Let's talk about the shopping, when things that happened that weren't so good.
We would go into, well, we would have to walk to Tremont Garden area, catch the bus to go in D.C. We always had to sit in the back of the bus. And when we get there, there was no place for us to eat or go to the bathroom. We would try to go into the stores. You have to go down in the basement, and then they wouldn't let you try on things. You have to just, you know, pick it up and look at it and see if this is what you can wear. They wouldn't let you try on a hat.
And you couldn't exchange it then?
No, you couldn't exchange it.
So what if you wanted something to drink? I heard that was a real problem.
It was only one or two places that would let you come inside to get something to drink. We would have to stand at the end of the counter, and we could stand there for hours, because if another white person came in, you can forget it. You can't, and they won't wait on you. And then when they finally waited on you, you had to take it out. You couldn't stand there and drink it.
Tell us about going to work. You used to work in the Pentagon, right?
Yeah, I worked at the Pentagon.
You had an exciting time working for...
Yeah. And then later on, my supervisor, Mrs. Peach, she says, to me, Myra, I think you would make a good waitress. So she put me in the officer's dining room to be a waitress. So I stayed in there for about maybe a month. And one of the girls, she was all sick. And so she told me, I want you to work in the general's dining room today. So I said, okay. And then that day, it just so happened that Ike Eisenhower came in. And he came in and I served him. And then later on, during that week, she kept me in there. And so he came to her and asked her, could I be his special waitress? So I was his special waitress. Then one day, he came in with Claude Gaber and Lionel Turner. So I was fortunate to serve them.
Well, you're a feisty gal. Tell them that incident on the bus, what you did.
Oh, my sister and I, we were working at the Heck Company. This was before I went to the Pentagon. Well, we were had to get off work at 8 o'clock, and I was working in the cafeteria with the Heck Company. So I was tired, and I told my sister, I said, we went to the Trailway station to get a bus to come home, and my dad would pick us up. So we got on the bus, and all the seats were completely full in the back. And just the door here, there's a seat here and a seat here. So all the rest of them was, full. So I sat here. And my sister said, Lamar, you can't sit there. I said, why not? It's an empty seat. And she said, but we are not in the back. I said, well, I said it real loud. I said, if they're going to make two of those whites get up, then I'll move. If they don't, I won't. And she said, the bus driver's not going to let you sit here. I pulled her down like I said, sit down. So we sat down. And we rode all the way from Washington, D.C. to Merrifield, and he ain't say a word. And Leo said, phew. When we got off the bus, she said, I thought sure he was going to tell us to get up. I said, I was tired. And I said, I wasn't going to stand up. And I said, if they were going to let two of the people in the back move, I'll move. And he heard me. I said it real loud. And they just looked at me. They didn't say nothing. Yeah. But we came all the way from 12th and Pennsylvania, New York Avenue, right on out to Merrifield, and got off that bus in Merrifield. My daddy picked us up, and we went home. But I said,
Good for you. Well, the last question is going to be you, Marion. Did integration in 85, was it 65? 1965. Did it change life for all of you?
You know, I think desegregation in Fairfax County was slow in coming. Because my first recollection is Fairfax County coming and telling my grandparents, you've got to leave. And so that totally altered our life. What we knew was no longer what we knew. And they still had to buy into the African-American community. So even though desegregation was a law, we were still segregated to the point where our churches were all black, our neighborhoods were still all black. A lot of places we still didn't go to. I was fortunate enough to go to Oakton High School in the 70s. You still didn't hear about African American history. You didn't hear about the importance of the slaves and their contributions to this country. The slaves built the capital, so on and so forth. You just didn't hear about things like that. And it's not really until the 80s where you see this progression of oral histories and really getting the importance of the African-American community in Fairfax County. And that's one of the reasons why this program is so important. And we applaud the Fairfax County Historical Commission and you, Naomi, for wanting to do this, because our family feels that our history is very important. We've been...
It is.
You know, I'm a seventh generation Fairfax, a seventh generation Virginian, sixth generation Fairfax County resident. And we want to make sure that people know about our family and the contributions that we've given to this county.
Well, we on the History Commission applaud you. And I'm so glad to have had this interview with you. And I know that the audience who view this are going to learn a lot about African Americans, your past and your future, which looks much, much more glorious. Thank you for coming.